Adventures in Illinois Law, Witnessing Tyranny Firsthand, an anthology by Shane Radliff. Originally published at libertyunderattack.com with a foreword by Kyle Reardon and a note by Matt Kay. This material is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution and Share Alike license. Reproduction of this anthology is encouraged, and credit to the author is appreciated.
Forward. Too many American patriots insist that we, the people, need to become more personally involved with municipal, county, or state government in order to defeat tyranny. Promotion of this wonderfully vague local government strategy is a recipe for disaster, for it encourages grassroots lobbying, petitioning the government for redress of grievances, and other such techniques that use the political means of making money, which is also known as reformism. Success in achieving freedom requires an honest assessment regarding the efficacy of one's methods. Understanding the violently coercive nature of government is imperative to restoring American liberty. Debunking the failed concept of participating in local government by going on political field trips where you personally experience government in its known natural habitat is, I think, the most effective way to move people along the other not-so-thin line towards repudiating government itself by living in a Lockean state of nature. Once constitutionalists give up any hope of working within the system in order to turn it against itself, then I think they will be primed to begin establishing local committees of safety, just as the founders of both America and Texas did. What is valuable about Shane Radliff's Adventures in Illinois Law anthology is that he demonstrates how the Illinois government, and specifically McLean County, is just as complicit in perpetuating tyranny as the federal government, if not more so. Shane's experience of being coerced to serve as a juror simply proves the necessity for privatizing the judicial branch by way of multi-tier dispute resolution, which even the federal judiciary tacitly recognizes, according to the Northern District of Ohio, the Western District of New York, and the Northern District of California. Ever since my collegiate days, I have gone on political field trips in order to experience government directly, although the only one I have blogged about thus far was the last one I went on 3 years ago to the Austin City Council, where they openly violated the 1876 Texas Constitution. No theory or book reading was required. Just good old-fashioned anthropological contact with government itself. Needless to say, whatever lingering doubts I had about libertarianism as an anti-political social philosophy were eradicated when I witnessed firsthand how limited government transgressed its very constitutional limits with absolutely no repercussions at all, and yet I am still expected by them to obey their laws. Please keep in mind as you read this anthology that Shane will make reference to what is commonly referred to amongst political scientists as the state. This is not the same as one of the 50 state governments within this highly overrated federal union. What Shane means when he says the state is any form or scope of government whatsoever. And yes, this includes American democratic republicanism as well. When he says the state, Shane is not referring to Illinois, Texas, or any other American state government, but rather the monopolistic institution of government itself. Kyle Reardon, Austin, Texas, August 2015.
Another adventure in Illinois law. Canceling my voter registration. Read by Shane Radliff, the author. Anyone who isn't the average American zombie is at least aware that voting in presidential elections is a joke. For those who are uniquely aware of this monopolistic entity known as government, they also recognize that voting in state elections is also a cruel joke, especially if you're like me and you live in the communist state of Illinois. As far as local elections go, that's your choice, but I've chosen to remove my consent from the rigged system in its entirety. I have, as of late, been looking for ways to remove my consent in perfectly legal ways. One of these ways was my recent purchase of silver. Being a 22-year-old college student, that is about all I can afford at this point, but nonetheless, it's a good first step. In addition to that, I'm considering encrypting my LUA email as well as my instant messaging. One other development is a recent conversation I had with Kyle Reardon. He mentioned that he canceled his voter registration quite easily in Texas. That was an intriguing thought, and I saw no reason not to pursue that angle as well. The process was much easier than I expected. Kyle and I began by going through all four branches of law for the state of Illinois. The Illinois Administrative Code, Section 216.50, stated that one of the reasons they will cancel your voter registrations is at the request of the registrant, which was applicable to my situation. When it came to the actual process of canceling voter registration, none of the four branches of law in Illinois addressed that. Instead, they referenced the United States Code, more specifically the National Voter Registration Act of 1993. Long story short, the United States Code lacked mentioning of canceling, except in the context of if someone was canceling it to re-register in another voting district. What all of the arms of Illinois law failed to mention was the process. What the referenced United States Code failed to mention was a process pertaining to anything other than that of a citizen who is moving to another county or state. Now, the first step I had in mind was either call or go to the government center in downtown Bloomington and just see if I'm even still registered, since I haven't voted since I was still a sheeple at age 18 or 19. Can't remember the exact age, but that detail is irrelevant. I decided to just head down to the government center after I attended my classes that day. Throughout this process, I will say, everyone there was really kind and helpful. Part of that is probably because they assumed I was making sure I was registered so I could go vote today in the consolidated election, whatever that is. But nonetheless, they were helpful. I told the government employee what I needed to find out if I'm still registered, and she went and looked it up, and I was. She started to mention a couple of status things, like telling me how to vote, where to vote, what I need to bring, etc., etc. And I politely interrupted and said, "Ma'am, I would like to cancel my voter registration altogether." And of course, she provided the exact statist facial expression that I was expecting. I gave her a Liberty Under Attack business card and said, "So what do I have to do to cancel it?" To my surprise, she said, "Well, all you have to do is write a note with your request, include your birth date, and sign it, and we'll send you something in the mail in a few weeks." So I won this battle, and luckily it was pretty simple. Granted, it's not going to make a significant difference, but it was certainly a personally satisfying action, and not only was the opportunity cost quite low, but now that I am a non-voter, I will enjoy lower opportunity costs than voters that have to care about electoral debates and voting on ballot measures. Hopefully, my endeavors will encourage others to do the same thing. Withdraw consent from this corrupt, rigged system. Remember, the first step is to look through your various state laws and then go from there. Your results may vary. Another adventure in Illinois law: jury summons. Read by Shane Radliff, the author. Back in November, I received my first letter summoning me to be a juror. At that time, I had just started a new job and really didn't want to take off work so early on, so I deferred until May. Well, May is almost here, and the dreaded letter came once again. I am being summoned to jury duty the week of May 11th. There are a few options that I have. First off, I could discreetly get chosen as a juror and nullify the law that the defendant is being charged with breaking, should it be an unjust law whose very enforcement violates my conscience. On the other hand, during jury selection, I could just say something along the lines of, quote, "I am a libertarian and/or an informed juror," which would certainly save me from having to ever serve as a juror. Legally speaking, more likely than not, the prosecutor would likely be more than happy to have the bailiff escort me out. Lastly, I could learn what the punishments are in the law for neglecting the jury summons in order to make an informed decision as to whether or not civil disobedience would be wise for me to perform. Of course, the legal maxim of ignorantia juris, non excusat, applies here, so I'm doing the best I can to understand the law, no matter how hard or confusing the lawyers make it sound. Within this summons letter, in the section titled Failure to Answer Jury Summons, it states, quote, in addition to any criminal penalty prescribed by law, a person summoned for jury service who does not comply with the summons as required by law is subject to contempt of court, punishable by incarceration. It definitely sounds intimidating. But there was no legal citation which indicated those things listed in the letter. And so my journey into legal land begins. As always, the place to start for me was in the Illinois Compiled Statutes. At 705 ILCS 305-15 from Chapter 78, Paragraph 15, Section 15, the law states this in regards to jury duty. Quote, every person who shall fail to attend when lawfully summoned to appear as a grand or petite jury without having a reasonable excuse shall be considered as guilty of contempt, and shall be fined by the courts respectively in any sum not less than $5 nor more than $100 for the use of the proper county, unless good cause can be shown for such default, and it shall be the duty of the court to enter an order of attachment, returnable forthwith, against all on the return thereof, the court shall proceed to assess the fine, unless the person or persons so attached shall show good cause for such delinquency, provided that the oath or affirmation of any such delinquent shall, at all times, be received as competent evidence. End quote. So quite frankly, as the law states, the punishment for failing to appear to a jury summons is a fine from $5 to $100. I will also add this, the daily pay is $10. It doesn't matter what job you have, even if it's minimum wage, you're taking a major pay cut to waste a day or even a week on jury duty. Now, isn't it interesting that the government is working to mandate $15 minimum wage, but they can only pay $10 a day for jury service? Hypocrisy much? Continuing on, I also looked through city ordinances, dug through the county and city websites, and the Illinois Administrative Code, yet this was the only citation I could find for a punishment for failure to comply to a jury summons. Now, for the sake of accuracy and safety, I decided to, again, head down to the Government Center in downtown Bloomington, as well as in McLean County Law and Justice Center. Now, in the interest of not having to pay for parking, I first went to the County Clerk's Office within the Government Center. I inquired about any specific codes, ordinances, or county laws regarding jury duty, since there were none available on their website. They really didn't have any answers, but I was told to go to the Law and Justice Center and see what I could find out. Across the street I go. I walked into the building and went through the metal detectors, and of course I set off the alarm since I have type 1 diabetes and therefore I must have an insulin pump on me 24/7. I did get an additional security theater screening by getting wanded, but at least they didn't pat me down or touch my junk. After successfully making it through security, I proceeded up to the third floor toward the court clerk's office. I will say it wasn't my first time there. Walked up to the desk and inquired about the codes, ordinances, or county laws, and she had a little more input than the nice ladies at the Government Center. She told me to go up to floor 5 and speak with Jason Daisy, who handles all things jury-related, and then to head up to floor 6 to the law library. I smiled and thanked her for her assistance and continued my journey through this belly of the beast known as local county government. I went up to floor 5, and there were no open doors, no people, and the courtrooms were empty, minus a couple people and a select few of them. I wandered down to the end of the hall, and to my right saw an open door at the end of the hallway. I walked down there, stood awkwardly, waiting for the gentleman to acknowledge me. He asked if he could help me, and I told him I was looking for Jason Daisy. He said that he was Jason Daisy and told me to come in. First try, that never happens within the bureaucracy. I said to him, "Hi, Mr. Daisy, my name is Shane, and I've just got a couple questions for you." And attempting to not be ignorant of the law, I'm working to understand and learn it as best as I can, and I need your assistance. I read the failure to appear section and handed him the letter. I told him that I am having trouble finding the legal citation that the summons letter refers to in regard to the incarceration aspect of the punishment. I told him I've been doing as much as I can and have only been able to find the citation for the fine aspect. To my surprise, well, actually not to my surprise, as the citizens are the only ones who are expected to know the law, unlike police officers and other government employees who are not expected to. Not surprisingly, he said he would have to do some digging for me, as he was not familiar with the law citation that this letter references. So I pulled out a Liberty Under Attack business card, turned it over, and wrote my phone number and email on it, and thanked him for his time, and that I look forward to hearing from him. And my journey through the belly of the beast called government continued, up to the sixth floor. I got out of the elevator and turned left, and the law library was on the right. I knocked on the door and walked in, and the library assistant greeted me and asked if she could help me find anything. I again explained what I was looking for, and also explained the journey I had made before coming to the law library. This kind lady assisted me more than all of the other three combined. As I recall in one of the discussions I had with Kyle Reardon, he mentioned to be extra nice to the law librarians, as they could be a major help in legal research. He was certainly correct. I asked her quite a few questions and got some good answers. There are no McLean County codes, ordinances, regulations, etc. McLean County falls under the purview of the various city ordinances and the Illinois compiled statutes. That includes the McLean County Law and Justice Center as well. She also went on to mention that she doesn't know anything about the actual citation the letter is referring to, but based off the legalese, she took it as failure to appear is considered contempt of court, which means it is up to the determination of the judge, which means that someone who fails to appear for a jury summons could only be required to pay a fine, or they could be incarcerated. I continued digging through statutory code for anything relating to the definition or circumstances surrounding contempt of court. I couldn't find anything, except when it related to things like someone not paying child support, having outstanding fees owed to the court, or some sort of a court order to appear. Then I started looking into some case law. It all started to make sense from that point on. From extensive Google searches, I found a page called Criminal Lawyer Illinois, and their page on contempt of court. They say that, quote, Illinois law does not have a statute for contempt of court. Instead, the rules for contempt come from common law. That is interesting. In the Illinois Constitution of 1970, yes, 1970, it was adopted at a special election. It is the current Constitution. Common law is mentioned once. In Article 7, Section 4D, it states that, quote, county officers shall have the duties, powers, or functions derived from common law or historical precedent unless altered by law or county ordinance. That is the only reference of common law in the current Illinois Constitution, yet they are using common law as the excuse for contempt of court. Criminal contempt of court has a penalty of up to 180 days in jail and a fine of $500. There are a bunch of different versions, such as indirect, direct civil contempt of court, and indirect, direct criminal contempt of court. And as far as the definitions, I won't bore you with that. There are a couple cases I'm to let my readers know what I would be up against if I decided to tell the court to stick it where the sun don't shine. In People v. Perez, 2014, Illinois App 3D120978, number 3-12-0978, on November 1st, 2014, it states, criminal is from conduct calculated to 1. Impede, embarrass, or obstruct the court in its administration of justice, 2. Derogate from the court's authority or dignity, or 3. Bring the administration of law into disrepute. According to People v. Perez, any attempt to, in the words of Eric Cartman, disrespect their authority might as well be indirect criminal contempt of court. Next is the punishment as ruled by this specific hearing, which aligns with others that I have found. People X. Rel. City of Chicago versus Le Mirage, 2013 Illinois App 1st 093547, numbers 1-09-3547 and 1-09-3549, cons, November 14th, 2013. It states that criminal contempt is punishable by fine or imprisonment. The power to punish for contempt is inherent and can neither be created nor limited by statute. Because it is not subject to legislation, contempt has no sentencing classification or range. That is only two of the case studies. It is sufficient. To conclude, you have seen the definition of what they call criminal contempt, at least here in Illinois, and you know the punishment. From the Criminal Lawyer Illinois page, you have also seen how they can legally enforce contempt of court, which, to reiterate, is common law. Even though the state of Illinois despises common law and any other aspect of freedom, hence why I call it the Communist State of Illinois. So from my investigation into the law, even without response from Mr. Daisy, my mind is already 99% made up. And of course, I couldn't rely on the employees that enforce or oversee the law to tell me these things. I had to find it out for myself. This experience has only made me despise the state even more. The law isn't understandable for the majority of the public, and even if it is, it's damn near impossible to find what you're looking for. When I did eventually discover what their law actually said, it more or less grants so much discretion to the judge that the courtroom might as well be his own little personal fiefdom. So, more often than not, I will have to venture back into the belly of the beast known as government, regardless of whether I end up in the courtroom serving as a juror, or I am thankfully rejected from such service during voir dire. I can honestly say, though, I'm looking forward to either outcome. For one, I will have an extremely gratifying feeling standing up for my morals and ethics if I am able to squirm my way out. Otherwise, maybe I can save a fellow citizen from a conviction on a criminal on a victimless crime. Either way, I will consider it a win, at least for me individually. Ignorantia juris non excusat. I'm doing my best not to be ignorant. They just don't make it easy. Another adventure in Illinois law. Felony scratching by Shane Radliff, written and published on May 12th of 2015, available at libertyunderattack.com. At about 2 o'clock today, my first case as a juror ended. The verdict was guilty and the charge was aggravated battery. The other jurors and I did not feel happy about the verdict, but the defense was quite weak and the state had a strong case. I will provide more details on this later on in this article. I was recommended by a colleague to do things in which I would stare straightism straight in the face. A couple of those things he recommended were attending a county board meeting and sitting in on a criminal court proceeding, but I did not expect to serve as a juror before being able to sit in the audience section. My experience as a juror was a productive exercise, and I plan on doing more things like that in the future, only in the next instance, it will be voluntary. Today, I took part in throwing a fellow citizen in a government dungeon. If you haven't read or listened to my preceding article in this series titled Adventures in Illinois Law, Jury Summons, I recommend you do that first. The case. Woke up at 6:45 a.m. Monday morning to begin preparing for the surely frustrating day ahead of me. I dressed myself in proper courtroom attire, grabbed my organic energy drink, and I was out the door. To get into the right mindset of nullifying the jury if needed, I did a couple of things. First off, I listened to Kyle Reardon's A Restoration Trilogy, and listened to a speech by Larkin Rose titled Anarchy, in which he goes in-depth describing the bullshit system we are encompassed by. Not quite sure if there is a better way to mentally prepare. I entered the Law and Justice Center at about 8:05 a.m. I made my way through the security station and headed up to floor number 5. I exited the elevator and turned left, and guess who I see? Mr. Jason Daisy, the same gentleman who I asked to assist me in finding the legal citations for the punishments described in the jury summons letter, and whom I never got a response from, not surprisingly. Mr. Daisy was the one checking everyone in and getting us our name tags, so we made contact as soon as I got there. I shook his hand and said, "Good to see you again, sir." Either he didn't remember me, or he pretended not to. Your guess is as good as mine. At that point, I went and took a seat and waited for something interesting to begin. Sat there for probably an hour, and then the McLean County Circuit Clerk, Don Everhart, stepped up to the podium to deliver us a welcome speech. He proceeded to turn on an introductory video on courtroom procedure and serving as a juror. And of course, it was made by the monopolistic Illinois Bar, British Accredited Registry, Association. My god, the propaganda was seriously intense. The video started by explaining how we're doing a noble thing as a trial by jury, as a trial by jury is one of the things that, quote, makes our injustice system the best in the world. Emphasis added by author. It's kind of funny and terribly ironic. Apparently they forgot about entrapment cases, erroneous charges, overcrowding prisons thanks to the failed drug war, civil asset forfeiture, the suspension of habeas corpus in some cases, and throwing people in a government dungeon for collecting rainwater. If that is justice, then the definition must have changed without my knowledge. Apparently they must have forgotten that the majority of cases never see a trial. Most just take the plea deal, which quite honestly would have been a better decision for the defendant in the case I was on the jury for the past couple of days. That point was made to us by the bailiffs, who said that jury trials have dropped significantly in the last 2 years. They mentioned that they work 2 weeks a month on average. The next claim by the bar attorneys is that through serving as a juror, we will have a better respect for the injustice system. I call bullshit. Day one was enough to make me despise this state and their coercive methods even more. Again, emphasis added by author. It was quite interesting that the judges featured in the video explained that we cannot judge the validity of the law, only the facts of the case, so we can reach a verdict. You know, it's not like I expected them to admit to everyone that they can judge the validity of a law through jury nullification. It's just a little hypocritical that if we were to lie in the courtroom, we'd be charged with perjury. And these corrupt bar attorneys lied to the potential jurors multiple times, and that's perfectly okay. And that was all about all that was interesting out of the introductory video, so I will move forward. After it ended, I sat and waited for about another 30 minutes or so and conversed with a couple of gentlemen that were at my table. It was meaningless small talk, but I did find out that I went to high school with one of my fellow potential jurors' daughters. Finally, Mr. Daisy approached the podium and informed us that they were selecting the first set of jurors. He announced 7 or 8 numbers, and then he called mine. I lined up at the double doors with the rest of them, I think there were 30-something others, and we proceeded to head into the first courtroom on the left. I saw the defendant and her attorney, and also saw the state's attorney. I took a seat with the rest of the potential jurors, and the judge addressed us. He went through his normal spiel and repeated the same lie that was stated in the video. Quote, "Your job isn't to determine whether the laws are good or bad. Your job is simply to hear the facts of the case and determine the guilt of the defendant," end quote. His next statement nearly made me break out in uncontrollable laughter because it was so retarded. Quote, "When you are done with your jury duty and you want to change a law or get it removed, call up Illinois Representative Dan Brady and he will help you in getting the law changed or removed," end quote. So according to the judge, the proper response to an unjust law is not jury nullification, but becoming a lobbyist. For those who are unaware, lobbying is legalized bribery. After another scripted, normal spiel, he informed us on the nature of the case. The charge is aggravated battery of a nurse, and it is worth a mention that he told us this before voir dire. It's surely not one that would permit jury nullification, because initiating force is mal in se, evil in itself. Voir dire took place with all of the jurors, not 4 at a time as previously stated. As far as I could tell, I didn't see any way out of it, and plus, I figured the chance was pretty small that I would get chosen. The judge asked us numerous questions, and then the lawyers got their turn to ask. The state's attorney asked how many of us watch shows like CSI, NCIS, Law & Order, etc., etc. Most everyone raised their hands, but I did not, as all of those shows just glorify law enforcement and the injustice system. His point was to inform us that those shows are unrealistic and that we shouldn't use anything we've learned in those shows, as it's probably wrong. Duh. To continue, we were in there for about an hour during voir dire, and then we were asked to go out into the hall while they selected the jurors. We were out there for about 10 or so minutes, and then they called us back in. To my surprise, I was selected as a juror in this case. He then asked all of us, not selected, to exit the courtroom. All of those not selected to exit the courtroom, and went on to tell us that we are not allowed to do any research on the case, to avoid newspapers, radio, and television for the remainder of the case, and that we couldn't even look up the legal citation for what the defendant is being charged for. How do they expect me, as a juror, to do my civic duty and render a judgment as to a serious matter of guilt or innocence without knowledge of the nature of the alleged crime? Isn't that the million-dollar question? The judge then let us know that the trial would start at 1:30 p.m. that afternoon. It was about 11 a.m. at that time, and we're on recess until then. I went to lunch and then returned to the courthouse. I rode the elevator back up to floor 5 and went to the jury deliberation room to wait until we were called back into the courtroom. That afternoon, we heard from two Bloomington firefighters, paramedics, who first arrived to take the defendant to the hospital. We heard from the registered nurse who was taking care of the defendant and who witnessed the offense. And finally, we heard from the charge nurse, the supervisory nurse, the one whom the defendant caused bodily harm to. It was 100% clear that the defendant did cause bodily harm to the charge nurse, and that was even admitted by the defense, but the defense was going for a verdict of not guilty by reason of insanity. The claimed reason was that the defendant suffered from epilepsy, and that she didn't know what she was doing due to her recent seizure. The witness called by the state, the four I mentioned above, all corroborated the story that the defendant was aware and oriented to person, place, and time. And for the sake of time and redundancy, I'll just summarize by saying this. The burden of proof for the aggravated battery charge was on the state, but the burden of proof for the insanity aspect was on the defense. As I mentioned above, the defense had a flimsy case for insanity, and plus, the defendant was caught in multiple lies while on the stand, which made us question her credibility altogether. The defense called two witnesses, one being the defendant, and the other being a forensic psychologist who actually heard the defense's case. The defendant also didn't help her cause any, and I'm still confused as to why she even volunteered to testify in the first place. The defense also stated that, I'm guessing, since the state would have if they hadn't, the defendant had been convicted of three prior charges, including harassment of a witness and prostitution. To conclude the case, I will reiterate the defense didn't have a case for insanity, and the state had an open and shut case for aggravated battery of a nurse. We heard the closing arguments from both attorneys, and then we were treated to the jury deliberation room. We were told our job and the procedure, and the bailiffs left us to decide the verdict. We all unanimously agreed that she was guilty of aggravated battery of a nurse. The only question left was, did the defendant have a case for insanity? We discussed for about 10 to 15 minutes about that, and also some other matters related to the case, and we all agreed that the bodily harm inflicted upon the nurse was very minor. She had scratches on her arms, and that was about it. That wasn't a highly discussed subject, as the defendant seemed like she had been in similar positions before and keeps finding her way back into court. We made our decision, signed the paper, and then were called back into the courtroom. The judge read the guilty verdict, and we were released from jury duty. Post-trial. I left the courthouse and started on my way back home to complete this article, and to also figure out what the defendant could possibly face. On the way home, I still couldn't morally justify throwing a fellow citizen in a government dungeon. Yeah, the defendant does have quite a history and definitely has some issues, but I still just don't like the fact that I contributed to someone's kidnapping. Although, as I mentioned before, I myself was coerced by government to serve on this jury. In addition to that, the injuries to the charge nurse were so minor, and at that time I didn't know what the defendant could potentially be facing as far as sentencing. Even before the sentencing, it only strengthened my support for private arbitration and dispute resolution. I arrived at home and first logged onto McLean County Public Access to see what the defendant had been charged with in the past. I will say she had a rap sheet a mile long, and that's no exaggeration either. I also looked at the potential sentencing she could be facing. Most aggravated battery charges are Class 3 felonies, which hold prison time from 2 to 5 years, or 5 to 10 years if the court finds aggravating factors. The aggravated battery charge pushed by the state in the trial was aggravated battery of a nurse, though, That part is important and could bump up the charge to a Class 1 felony, which carries sentencing of 4 to 15 years. I'm unsure as to which one they will charge her with, but since she didn't take a plea deal, she'll probably not get any good deals on this one. Also, her previous charges aren't going to help her out any. Think it's also worth a mention that circumstances like this happen every single day in hospitals, and we as jurors were there to determine whether the defendant was guilty of felony scratching. There were other details shared with us regarding her violence towards other members of the hospital staff, some more severe, but we were only told to focus on the nurse. It's a common law principle that the punishment must fit the crime, and after looking at the law after the case, I have a tough time understanding how the defendant deserves years in a government dungeon for felony scratching. She's not facing days, she's not facing weeks, she's not facing months, she's facing years. It's not like our prisons are empty by any means. America actually holds 25% of the world's prison population, and the prisons are already overcrowded. In a truly free society, what the defendant would owe to the nurse in the form of restitution is the cost of any bandages as well as an apology. Not rotting away in a taxpayer-funded dungeon. So all in all, it was definitely a learning experience. Certainly didn't enjoy it, though. I still resent the fact that I was forced to contribute to a fellow citizen being thrown in a government dungeon, but something needed to be done. And unfortunately, since this is a system we live in, there really weren't any alternatives, especially considering the potential punishments I would have faced had I chosen to civilly disobey the government. In addition to that, she did violate the non-aggression principle, and in the moral and just society I envision in the future, that would be one of the most severe things one could do to a fellow human being, because all initiatory force is immoral. The current system we have in place now does not work on behalf of the citizenry. The system isn't broken. It's working just as it's intended to. Something needs to change. And quickly. You've just heard Another Adventure in Illinois Law, Felony Scratching, read to you by the author, Shane Radliff, published on May 12th, 2015, available at libertyunderattack.com. Adventures in Illinois Law, Part 1, Draconian Legislature at the County Level. Read by the author Shane Radliff, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on May 21st, 2015. Part 2 will be released this week. Introduction. There's certainly a major issue in our society when it comes to those with mental deficiencies and the wrongdoings they commit because of said deficiencies. I'll be the first to concede in that argument. Although I feel like the focus is extremely misplaced. The majority of the focus seems to be placed on those that use vices. That could range from alcohol to marijuana, all the way to methamphetamine. Yes, there may be some issues, minor or major, with those that choose to use some of these substances, but it should not be a crime for people to use these substances, as no individual or entity should be able to tell you what you can or cannot put into your body. That decision is yours. The major reason that these vices are even a problem in our society is because of the cash cow of a black market that is created by their proposed illegality. As we've seen with plenty of examples, Colorado for one and Portugal for another, once the illegality is taken out of these substances, people are more likely to seek help for their addiction and the crime rates drop significantly as the drugs aren't profitable anymore and they're also not in danger for admitting their problem. The true issue with the manufactured drug problem in our society is the draconian legislation that it allows the King's Guards to toss someone in a government dungeon for 25 years for possessing a plant. The question to ask yourselves is this: who are the real people with mental deficiencies? The ones that use these easily accessible drugs thanks to the war on drugs, or those that pass legislation in conjunction with the complete and utter fail of a policy known as the war on drugs? Those with the most dangerous mental deficiencies are those that pass and support this legislation for the common good, which always increases the size and control of government, as well as their financial portfolio, especially when it relates to the drug war. And to reiterate a point I've made many times previously, it always results in the destruction of your freedoms, and should be something consistently and vehemently opposed. All I've said before this point builds up to my extremely recent attendance of the McLean County Board meeting and the legislation that has recently gone into effect. one day after said attendance, to be more specific. Buildup. I attended the McLean County Board meeting on May 19, 2015, which was in fact my birthday. Before I move forward to the original intent of what has turned into part two of this article, I feel there are some important things to mention in regards to my surely unique experience. They range from tax levies across the board to the normal parliamentary procedure, all the way to the stated speeches where I have unfortunately come in contact to, where I have unfortunately come in contact to in prior circumstances on more than one occasion in the past week. The McLean County Board Meeting. The date was May 19, 2015. I entered the Government Center in downtown Bloomington at approximately 8:50 a.m., about 10 minutes prior to the start of the board meeting, in room 400. I entered the room and sat down near the back of the relatively small room. I sat down and prepared for what I was about to endure, took a few sips of my non-fluoridated alkaline water, and waited patiently for it to begin. At about 9 a.m., the incompetency of government already started to show. At about that time, Mrs. Kathy Michael, the McLean County Clerk, who just within the past week received my most recent article on her Facebook page regarding me being forced to serve as a juror, stood up and said something along the lines of, "This meeting will be postponed temporarily as we're waiting on some printed material. We'll provide cocktails while you wait." And obviously, that's not verbatim, but the important part is that they were not prepared for the meeting. And I wish I could cite it precisely, but McLean County hasn't provided the audio that they promised since April, and my memory is not perfect. But moving along, I was simply a spectator. I was watching the actions of everyone in that room and their interactions with the bureaucrats, as well as many other things. The first thing I noticed was that I was the youngest one in the room by at least 30 years, minus one 30-something old lady. I'm assuming she was another one of those gynos, journalists, and name only, but I surely hope I'm proven wrong. The next thing I noticed was the copious amount of older folks there, 65 and up. From what I saw at my first and hopefully only appearance at a county board meeting, it seems like they've dropped the 6 a.m. meetings for coffee and breakfast and have started attending county board meetings instead. The first thing I felt was a sense of not belonging. The thought actually entered my mind that I would be involuntarily committed or arrested for some arbitrary law. Unfortunately, that was not some ridiculous fear manufactured in my mind, but certainly one I was worthy of having, especially considering the views that I hold and have openly written about and have semi-teased to bear with. Thankfully, it only stayed in my mind for a few seconds, and after that momentary point, my mind was open to listen and watch what was happening before my eyes. First thing I noticed a few minutes after I entered was one bureaucrat speaking to two gentlemen at a table way off to my right side. I saw this bureaucrat approach them, and I witnessed the two folks' eyes light up and their faces glowing, a sense of humility and respect just being in this person's presence. It immediately made me consider a quote from one of Larkin Rose's books. Quote, "You feel pride being able to say you once shook a senator's hand or saw the president in person. Ah, yes, the grand deity himself, his royal highness, the president of the United States of America. You speak the title as if you're referring to God Almighty," end quote. Now, it may not be a senator or president's hand, but regardless, it's still a form of higher authority, and that is universal. It doesn't matter what title, what level, or what jurisdiction. Authority is authority, and the point is that they envision this man as being above them. Continuing on, about 10 or so minutes late, the meeting convened. First item on the official McLean County agenda was the call to order. Nothing substantial about that. The next was something called an invocation. For those like me who are previously unaware of what that meant, the multiple definitions from Merriam-Webster include definition number one, quote, "the act of asking for help or support, especially from a god," end quote. Definition number two, quote, "a prayer for blessing of guidance at the beginning of a service, ceremony, etc., end quote. Definition 3, quote, "a calling upon for authority or justification," end quote. Immediately, there's something very wrong here. Either this invocation was a request from a god or calling upon for authority or justification. Since the majority of Merriam-Webster's definitions involve some sort of a god or deity, let me just post a couple of quotes here to prove to you how wrong it is for this sort of thing to happen in any legal setting. First is a quote from Alexis de Tocqueville's book, Democracy in America, from chapter 17. Quote, as a member of the Roman Catholic Church, I was more particularly brought into contact with several of its priests. They mainly attributed the peaceful dominion of religion in their country to the separation of church and state. The last one is an excerpt from the Treaty of Tripoli, Article 11, quote, the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, end quote. Whether it's a call for authority or a prayer, it really doesn't matter. The simple fact that someone or multiple people are claiming authority over you is wrong in so many ways. As Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse 32, quote, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make ye free, end quote. You can't be free and have people ruling over you. That's just not possible, and every single instance of any ruler in history will prove it to you. There is much more, so please let me continue. For the sake of conforming, I stood up when the Pledge of Allegiance came up. I did hold my hand over my heart as I do not worship this flag, which I explained in a previous article. The Pledge of Allegiance was actually started by a socialist, Francis Bellamy, which most are completely unaware of. It's no coincidence that this is damn near force in every single government school across the nation. After the Socialist Pledge of Allegiance, what came after that was roll call. There's nothing substantial about that either, but I did notice a few board members that were absent, which isn't a surprise. Matt Sorensen then informed the rest of us that the order of the agenda was going to be changed, and what transpired next was certainly interesting. Again, I'm awaiting the audio, as government at any level is incompetent, but I will share the exact state of speech audio as soon as they put it up, but my god, it was fantastic. There was a lady who surely looked like a hippie that approached the podium. Before I paraphrase what she said, it's interesting to see her change in mindset since Woodstock up until today. Although I did find out from a colleague that most Woodstockers have left behind their values and ideals that they previously held, so it's really not a surprise. She approached the podium and said something along the lines of how the Coffee with Cops program was fantastic and that it allowed her to understand what they go through on a daily basis and how hard and dangerous their jobs are. She went on to state that the armory reenactments also showed her how fantastic they were at teaching and indoctrinating the public how to, I guess, defend themselves from a civil war or World War II attack. No, it sounds vague, but in my research, I couldn't find anything else other than those two examples, and this may require clarification later, but I will take that risk. The point is this. Her and every other person in there, except for me, obviously, were bleeding sadism out of every single orifice on their body. There was one other award from a cop as well, but I honestly don't remember his name or the reason, but it's worth a mention in passing. Next, there is a proclamation of the McLean County Board in recognition of Paul Penn. This was probably the point where I was the most confused. This man passed away on May 7th, and I still have no idea why he was honored at this meeting. From what some bureaucrats said, he was a local business owner and did a lot for the community. From looking at his obituary, I am just as lost as before. Not to disrespect this man's life at all, but I would like some explanation as to why he was honored when people in this county die every single day with a lot of the same qualifications. In addition to that, why wasn't that time allocated towards the budget, appointment positions, or towards the overall freedom of those that live within the county borders? I will never get an answer to that question. The rest of the meeting made me feel like I was literally being robbed. All I ever heard were minutes regarding the budgetary allocations for fiscal year 2015, or in a few cases, emergency appropriations, for whatever said piece of legislature that was. They had their hands in my pockets by way of tax levies, regardless of how small they were. I don't care what it is, what it's for, or for how much. Taxation is theft. I was again thoroughly disgusted by the position I found myself in. In this instance, it was voluntary, but in the jury summons instance, it was not. In both cases, I found myself thoroughly disgusted with what I was witnessing. Only at least in this instance, on my birthday, I only came across the blatant robbery of my hard-earned dollars, and I wasn't forced to contribute to the tossing of a fellow citizen in a government dungeon for felony scratching. I will end with this. I despise being in a room full of Democrats that are either lusting for power or those that naively think that what they are doing is for the good of the people. I despise being in a room where I knew and felt like I didn't belong. It was probably the most traumatic feeling. In addition to that, and I don't know how anyone else could, in addition to that, I don't know how anyone could enjoy being in a room with people that are wasting their money and legislating nearly every aspect of their life, even at a county level. What I learned was that government at all levels is incompetent and does not care about your freedoms, no matter how much they tell you they do. It's important to not form any distinction between a lower form of authority or a higher form. It's all authority, and they all have some sort of control over your life. This will be concluded in part two, and that is the most important part of this article. If you want to see a legislature that truly puts a limited amount of freedoms you have left at risk in McLean County, stay tuned. You've just heard Adventures in Illinois Law, Part 1, Draconian Legislature at the County Level. Read by the author Shane Radliff, originally published on May 21st, 2015, at libertyunderattack.com, and Part 2 will be released this week. Adventures in Illinois Law, Part 2, Draconian Legislation at the County Level. Read by Shane Radliff, the author, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on May 27th, 2015. Part 1 of this two-part series can be found at libertyunderattack.com/LUA-news. Introduction. When it comes to the federal government, most people expect a draconian, freedom-destroying legislation. Although it seems like most people don't understand that government is government, no matter what level. Governments always expand, they always rob the citizens of more and more money over time, and they always restrict freedom, most of the time for the common good, regardless of their federal, state, or local title. In part one of this article, I described what I saw when I attended the McLean County Board meeting on May 19, 2015. I also gave the readers a basic premise as to what kind of legislation this is from the introduction of that first installment. In part two, I would like to present to you a piece of draconian legislation coming right out of the local county government. The document that we'll be looking at today is titled Mental Health Action Plan by the McLean County Board, released on May 19, 2015. Analyzing the legislation. As I began reading this, I immediately saw a major issue. In the background section, it discusses multiple previous attempts to curb the mental health and substance abuse problem in McLean County. I already knew what I was looking at, and it was a reform of a reform that will again expand the size of government quite significantly. Government failed multiple times on this issue, and now they want more money and more power because of their failure, much like how the National Security Agency fails to increase national security. It goes on to explain a rising trend of co-occurring mental health patients and drug offenders within the community, but the first significant part is the next few sentences. Quote, a team of court officers led by Chief Judge Elizabeth Robb identified the opportunity to develop what was then an emerging philosophy of providing a specialized judicial proceeding to address the increasing challenges these co-occurring mental health patients create. The court worked in concert with the McLean County Board and community leaders to obtain congressional support for a Department of Justice drug court grant. This grant was authorized in September of 2008, and McLean County became of Illinois' first drug court, end quote. In the article linked to Chief Judge Robb, it reveals that Governor Rauner named her to a state reform panel on improving the Illinois prison system. My assumption that this was a reform to another reform was proven correct. In that excerpt from that document, it shows federal involvement by the Department of Justice in the granting of the first drug court in Illinois, headquartered in McLean County. As I explained in Part 1, the war on drugs is a complete and utter failure, and this piece of legislation is another governmental expansion under the guise of the war on drugs, otherwise known as narcotics prohibition, both in McLean County and also the federal government as well. Moving along, the next example of federal involvement at the county level appears a paragraph down the page and again led to a further expansion of government and even a new council. Quote, in 2008, McLean County also requested that the National Institute of Corrections, NIC, complete a report on the adult jail system within McLean County. This report was completed in January 2009. The major outcome of this assessment was a recommendation to form a criminal justice coordinating council, end quote. In the following paragraph, we learn that the DOJ drug court grant expired in 2009. The McLean County Board then, through its Board of Health, appropriated local funding to continue the McLean County drug court. Subsequently, Illinois state laws mandated the provision of a drug court in all jurisdictions. The previously mentioned Criminal Justice Coordinating Council, CJCC, was established on July 1, 2009, and its tasks were to examine policies and procedures at the McLean County criminal justice system. In layman's terms, they wanted to examine the most recent reform to see if a reform of the prior reform was needed. I know that may sound redundant, but it was intentional. It appeared that the federal government was proud of the success of the CJCC, and in 2013, McLean County applied for a second DOJ drug court grant, a Bureau of Justice Assistance, BJA, mental health court grant, and grants from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, SAMHSA, for both drug and mental health court. To recap, in just 5 years, McLean County has been involved with at least four federal governmental entities. I think it's also worth a mention in passing that the BJA has an abusive track record of unjust profiling of American citizens, and I am not happy with their involvement in the McLean County government. Although, I would rather see government abolished, so I suppose that statement doesn't mean a whole lot. In the following couple of years, McLean County requested the NIC return twice to review various provisions and also complete a number of reports. In January of 2014, the McLean County Board issued a request for proposals for jail needs and assessment and pre-architectural design. In February of 2014, the McLean County Board Executive Committee convened two interagency public-private work groups, one to identify community mental health needs and one to identify best practices. The following month, in March of 2014, the Bloomington Normal and McLean County Economic Development Council brought community leaders together and they traveled to Washington, D.C. to meet with legislators and staff members from the Department of Health and Rehabilitative Services and the Department of Justice to discuss community challenges. To conclude, this action plan includes immediate and long-term steps for the community and the county board to consider and act upon. Before I move forward, I think there is something important worth mentioning. The morning that I was going to the McLean County board meeting, I was conversing with a family member. He said he thinks it's a great idea that I'm going to the meeting, as local government is easier to hold accountable. I quickly told him that that is not why I'm going, as reformism has proven time and time again to be a complete waste of time and a failure. The questions that need to be asked are, if there's so much federal government intervention, is it really local government? Or is it just an extension of the federal government? And lastly, wouldn't it be realistic to drop the entire notion of trying to reform from the ground up when the federal government's tentacles are so deep inside the McLean County government? I would like to hear an answer to that question from the local Libertarian Party. Moving along, the next part is titled Executive Summary. They give quite a few reasons as to why the prior reform was ineffective, ranging from a lack of interagency communication and data sharing to the mental health support in jails and prisons not being sufficient, and lastly, the lack of mental health practitioners, to name a few. Later on in the executive summary, they mention that this action plan engages a varied group of organizations, including state and federal agencies, law enforcement, judicial and court officers, and other stakeholders. In the following paragraph, it states, and I'm paraphrasing, that the community is committed to a multi-step planning process that can achieve concrete results. I bet that's what they said about the last reform, too, but look at where we are now. In 5 years, they'll be right back in the same position, reforming yet another reform. Continuing on, if you're a McLean County resident, this next part should make your wallet hurt. It states that today, the majority of mental health funding comes from property taxes, which is another reason public schools in Illinois are millions of dollars in debt, and that the revenue funding streams need to be diversified to pay for this community obligation. There are already a couple of short-term goals that they have already fulfilled. In 2014, the Bloomington Federally Qualified Health Center, FQHC, provider, Chestnut Health Systems, was awarded $500,000 to provide expanded mental health services. Next, the FQHC at the county's Fairview campus was expanded to provide more people treatment. Lastly, the State of Illinois Department of Human Services committed an annual $700,000 investment to allow Chestnut to establish an adult mental health crisis and substance abuse detox program for McLean County. Chestnut Health Systems made out quite well with this one. $1.2 million in 2014 with another $700,000 annually, in addition to the expanded facility at the Fairview campus. The next section is titled County Board Action Objectives. There are about 20 of them on this list, but for the sake of time, I'll mention a couple. In the other long-term objectives section, one of the goals is for McLean County to become the payer of last resort for mental health services. Another non-surprising one from the amount of federal intervention touched on briefly so far is that the McLean County Board wants to continue to engage federal and state legislators regarding community needs. To conclude this section, you can clearly see this action plan is heavily focused on drug users. It is also easy to see that we can expect taxes to go up in McLean County to help pay for this costly reform. The amount of federal intervention and assistance is also highly prevalent. It seems the mindset is constantly one reform away from utopia or one law away from utopia, when both have been proven failures time and time again. Although, what can you really expect from a bunch of statists that believe in the most dangerous superstition known as government? I've got the solution to this grievance. A good place to start, if the several American legislatures wanted to, would be to repeal the Federal Controlled Substances Act of 1970 or, for example, the Texas Controlled Substances Act of 1989. From reading the document, most of the crucial information has already been provided. The rest is bureaucratic jargon and quite a few tables and charts. Yet, there are still some important points to touch upon. The Criminal Justice Coordinating Council, CJCC, has been mentioned multiple times so far, but in addition to that, one of the tasks is to create a McLean County Behavioral Health Coordinating Council, BHCC. In short, the BHCC would be the umbrella for organizations in the behavioral health systems and will be a conduit for information sharing. The members of the BHCC would be appointed by the chairman of the McLean County Board, the current one being Matt Sorensen. On page 18 of this document, there is a system structure for behavioral health. I'm showing you this to provide an example of the bureaucracy that exists locally. The majority of residents in this county have surely never heard of any of these administrations, groups, boards, or coordinators. Note the tax levy and budget section. On page 19, the task is to appoint a mental health advisory board and also calls for the expansion of the role of behavioral health and development disabilities coordinator. On page 20, it calls for the development of standardized data collection guidelines, as well as McLean County becoming becoming the payer of last resort. In other words, the poor sap taxpayers. On page 21, they call for the exploration of a grant writer or a grant coordinator, and on page 23, they call for the creation of interagency training. The next important section is titled Housing, and it starts on page 46. They call for an addition in size to the McLean County Jail for numerous reasons. One of them being the need to provide a therapeutic environment for those incarcerated who cannot tolerate placement within the general population. Next is the expansion of the welfare state. In the section titled Short-Term Action Plan, they seek additional federal housing vouchers and funding for construction of subsidized housing and to work with rental groups for an additional housing option. I would imagine that would be similar to the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, their Fair Housing Equal Opportunity Program, only on a more local level. In the section titled Crisis, on page 55, there is a behavioral crisis flowchart. There's nothing substantial about this chart, except there is a mention of involuntary commitment. There are no definitions, no procedural lists or charts or anything, which is certainly interesting and something I need to dig further into. The rest of the document is almost worthless, so that will conclude the analysis of the legislation. The war on drugs has only brought with it overflowing prisons, destroyed lives and families, it's contributed to the complete implementation of the police state, civil asset forfeiture, otherwise known as legalized highway robbery, and in this instance, draconian legislation that is passed under the guise of solving the drug problem. If there is one thing that should have been learned by now, it's that tossing someone in a government dungeon for a vice does not work. It also creates a black market that increases violence, gang activity, and overall crime. The legislation that was analyzed in this article will not solve a single aspect of the drug problem. It is an easy hypothesis to make, just look at how many prior reforms have been implemented before this one. There will be a few for sure ramifications from this legislation. The taxes will have to go up in McLean County to fund this. Also, the size and control of government will also increase, as that is what happens with every single reform. There are a couple of possibilities that could also occur. With the focus being on drug users, we could see an increase in civil asset forfeiture as well as an increase in drug rates. The mention of involuntary commitment without a definition is also a major issue. The real people with mental deficiencies are not those that use vices. They are the ones that ignore all real statistics and empirical evidence and would rather waste time and taxpayer money on legislation that is bound to fail. So what is the solution? The first one is already semi in motion, and more states need to follow suit of Washington State and Colorado, the decriminalization or legalization of drugs. The final solution is to look at all the evidence of reformism failing throughout history of throughout the history of government and stop wasting your time doing something that doesn't work. Withdraw all consent and make yourself as individually free as you possibly can. The first of those that I would recommend is canceling your voter registration. Government is government. It doesn't matter what level. In this case, it was county level, but with lots of assistance and grants from the federal government. All levels have the ability to pass irrational, illogical, draconian legislation. The issue isn't the size of the government, and it's not a failed system. It's working just as it's intended to, and it's about time we open our eyes and see that. If we don't, the ramifications will be deadly. Author's note. All of the sources are either linked in the article or can be found in the reference document that will be uploaded along with the article. You've just heard Adventures in Illinois Law Part 2, Draconian Legislation at the County Level, read by the author Shane Radliff, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on May 27, 2015, and part one of this two-part series can be found at libertyunderattack.com/LUA-news. Proof of Success. Canceling My Voter Registration, originally published on June 25th, 2015 at libertyunderattack.com and read to you by the author. Back in April, I began my attempt to cancel my voter registration. I followed the instructions of the kind government employee and waited for proof of cancellation to come in the mail for a few weeks. I then went back when I was summoned to serve on a jury, and she said they weren't going to send anything, and they didn't have anything they could give me for proof. Well, me being the person I am, I wanted something to frame and put up in my sorry-for-an-excuse studio, and also proof that it really does work. So today, during my adventure of observing a criminal court proceeding, I trundled on down to the government center in downtown Bloomington and tried a third time. This visit provided me a different government employee, and she actually provided me proof of my canceled status. Even in the communist state of Illinois, it's rather easy to cancel your voter registration. Now, getting them to provide proof may take a few steps, but it's still very much worth it, in my opinion. The redacted document is available on the original article and in the anthology. You've just heard Proof of Success, Canceling My Voter Registration, originally published on June 25, 2015 at libertyunderattack.com and read to you by the author. Adventures in Illinois Law. A voluntarist observes a coercive courtroom. Originally published at libertyunderattack.com on June 25th, 2015. Read to you by the author. To conclude my adventure in Illinois law series, I attended criminal court proceedings this morning. I've written about the legislative branch when I attended the McLean County Board meeting last month. However, this is not my first time in a courtroom, the first one being coerced by a jury summons last month. The only difference between then and now is, back then, I was forced to attend with the threat of contempt of court for failing to do so. And also, the proceedings I attended today were not jury trials or even bench trials, but rather plea deals and pretrial hearings. This will conclude the series unless some other form of draconian legislation is brought before the McLean County Board, or if I decide to take it to the next level, which I will more than likely do. The preparation started a couple of nights prior to attending when I started digging through the 14-day docket, which was easily available on the McLean County website. My goal was to find a few I was interested in that were in the same courtroom at the same time, and I found just that. At 10 a.m. in courtroom 3D, there were a few possession charges and a couple of disorderly conducts. That certainly seemed the most intriguing, as I was trying to avoid any violations of the non-aggression principle, property rights, and DUIs, for obvious reasons, because I was trying to stick to victimless crimes. This morning I woke up and headed to the McLean County Law and Injustice Center. Parking was much cheaper than I imagined, so that's definitely a good thing. I headed in and went up to the third floor and waited until the proceedings began. After standing there for a couple of minutes, the bailiff walked up to me and asked if I needed a check-in. I said, no, I don't. That was all I ever said in this adventure. 10 o'clock rolled around and I was a little intimidated to enter, and rightfully so. I didn't know the proper procedure for someone witnessing court proceedings. I knew it was legal, as a couple of folks did it when I served as a juror. Although all I could remember is what I learned in attempting to not be ignorant of the law in my jury summons endeavor. The courtroom is literally the judge's little fiefdom, and he can charge someone with contempt of court for whatever reason he makes up. A couple of minutes later, I saw a number of people enter and leave the courtroom, and I decided to slip in and sit down. The first defendant was being charged with possession of marijuana and residential burglary. Obviously, that would be a violation of both the non-aggression principle and property rights. From how it seemed at the trial, it appeared to be two different charges, and the only one being addressed today was the marijuana charge. The defendant took a plea deal. That is an extremely common trend. I remember that when I served as a juror, the bailiff even said that jury trials have dropped significantly in the past 2 years, and he only works about 2 weeks out of every month. Second defendant was charged with criminal trespassing, obviously a violation of property rights. There were a couple of other things mentioned in regards to his case, but again, the defendant took a plea deal. The third defendant was charged with disorderly conduct, a charge that can mean a lot of different things, drunk in public, loitering, disturbing the peace, etc., etc. A minor offense with no victim. There was no evidence presented, so obviously there's no way to judge innocence or guilt. In addition to that, the only events in this certain case was that the trial was pushed back to a later date. The fourth defendant was charged with only possession of canceled or suspended license. As far as why it was suspended, the McLean County Public Access System only states ordinance violation prior to the charge. The only other open charge is consumption of liquor as a minor. Nothing that explains why he had a canceled or suspended license. And let's be honest here. Who has not drank as a minor? The drinking age laws were arbitrarily established by the hallucinatory entity known as the state. Based off of public records, it appears this teenager will be spending some time on probation for not obeying the arbitrary laws of his masters, including their claimed monopoly on roads, and complete disregard for his inalienable right to travel. The fifth defendant's only charge was possession of drug paraphernalia. He was the only one that came in escorted by a cop from the government dungeon, otherwise known as the McLean County Jail. It was quite interesting to hear the judge's explanation. I don't have a perfect memory, so I will paraphrase. We found a pipe in which the victim was going to ingest a controlled substance into his body, which is a misdemeanor offense that could be a year in jail or a $750 fine. So let's recap. The only one that came from the government dungeon, remember, there were charges of residential burglary and criminal trespassing, both actual crimes, was the one that did nothing wrong. This is also known as a vice crime. No victim, but government's very biased opinion on drugs claimed that it was wrong. Not to mention their vested interest, for example, expanding government from the successful, for them, drug war, and also the CIA's involvement in smuggling those same drugs in. Now let's say the government banned mac and cheese. No one could possibly have a moral objection to someone eating mac and cheese, and some would even pay a lot for it if it were to be arbitrarily outlawed. Now you have a black market and macaroni and cheese. Sound absurd? In Wisconsin, there used to be a ban on margarine. You know what that created? A black market for margarine. Black markets are only created by arbitrary laws, and everything that is black market today is only that way because the state makes a lot of money off of it, and or they get to increase the prison slave population. To conclude, he pled guilty and was sentenced to 60 days in jail, but had already served 10. 2 months of your life is a very long time, especially for a victimless crime. The sixth defendant didn't show up. I witnessed the public defender speaking to the state prosecutor, explaining that his client didn't show up and that he had tried to call him and his assistant was currently trying to get a hold of him. Now, as far as him being a public defender, I don't have any documentation for that, but seeing him speak to the state prosecutor with a grin on his face was enough for me. That, and the body language that was shared by both of them. It seemed like they were, at the very least, work acquaintances. Surprisingly, the state went easy on him and just rescheduled the hearing. The seventh defendant was being charged with disorderly conduct. Again, that could be public intoxication, disturbing the peace, or loitering. As with the last one, no evidence was presented, and the trial was pushed back to a later date. All of this happened in just 30 minutes. The state ran seven citizens through the gauntlet in just half an hour, the majority of them being victimless crimes. They destroyed lives from reckless whims and had no regard for morality, as they were just enforcing the law. That is no fucking excuse. They're either authority-obeying cowards, or they are lusting for power to control others. Both are wrong, and they both need to be called out. I also think it's important to touch on the way that these government agents interacted with each other. For one, the court clerk's unwavering servitude to the judge really bothered me. She could be doing something good, but instead she believes in authority, the injustice system. Much like my statist cousin lawyer trying for a judge, a Reaganite, who believes in the Constitution, but cannot even understand the fact that her own occupation violates her own beliefs. Unlike the McLean County Board meeting I attended, where the occupants were humbled to be in the presence of authority, the defendants acted in a little different manner. They acted like they were at the mercy of the judge, when in reality their case was already decided when they took the plea bargain. They couldn't resist calling him Your Honor, Sir, or any other title that resembles authority. Regardless of the status of their case, it was pretty clear to see that they still believed in this elaborate illusion called authority. As I stated in my article on the McLean County Board meeting, it seemed like the government employees, and the defendants alike, recognized that they were in the presence of some authority figure. To make another distinction, at the McLean County Board meeting, it was, for some reason, a joyful atmosphere. The attendees were happy to be in the presence of their political rulers. But at court today, the defendants expressed a saddened atmosphere, and rightfully so. Lastly, since I've mentioned my experiences in both the judicial and legislative branches, I think it's important to mention that I've had prior events with the executive enforcement branch of government here as well. Leaving out basic traffic infractions, the first serious infraction I had with a police extortionist was when I was a reckless teenager. Even though they destroyed my car, they didn't find the rest, or I would have gone to jail. You can put that on the police's incompetence, or that I just had a really good hiding spot. Both would be true. I got my car towed, stolen, and only got tagged with an ordinance violation. It doesn't show up on my record as anything but that. You could, and you would be right, call it extortion. I had to pay my way out of incarceration. Keep in mind, this was all for a victimless crime. The next experience I had with these police extortionists was when I got a DUI a few years back. I got off relatively clean, it doesn't show up on my record. I did owe the state a lot of money, though. So, as you can see, I've had experience with all three branches of local government, and none of them good. In the legislature, I could literally feel them reaching to my wallet and raping me of my hard-earned dollars, otherwise known as taxation, which is theft. They also approved the Mental Health Action Plan, which has had involvement from at least four federal agencies and uses the successful War on Drugs as the precursor for their expansion of local government. In the judiciary, I saw firsthand that they are not advocates of common law. To be more specific, they don't believe that the punishment must fit the crime. I also saw the judge advocate for lobbying, and he also lied to the jurors by saying that it's not our job to judge whether a law is good or bad, completely ruling out a jury nullification. In the executive enforcement branch, I was a victim of extortion due to a victimless crime. From my experiences, I have a unique perspective. I believe that government is immoral and goes against all values that us humans frequently hold precious. For example, we find ways to solve problems in our lives without initiating violence or the threatening use of coercion, which usually are the only two options available to the state. In addition to that, I have witnessed firsthand that no matter what level of government, the state is the most dangerous robber, theft, or con man that has ever existed on this earth. They don't give a damn about your life, liberty, property, or happiness. Governments throughout the history of the world, there's no shortage of empirical evidence, have always grown tyrannical and have always committed democide, murder by government, the inevitable end of statism. I have proven all of this at a local level. Maybe not the executive branch from a personal experience, but there have been plenty of examples of police extortionist corruption in this county. So what does that say about the state in general? Well, to put it simply, a state is a state is a state. I don't care if you call it federal, state, or county, or municipal. It's time to get rid of this ridiculous hallucination of authority and start being the moral, responsible human beings we all can be. So what's it gonna be? Freedom or slavery? You can't be free with a political ruler. You've just heard Adventures in Illinois Law, a voluntarist observes a coercive courtroom, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on June 25th, 2015, read by the author. Sentencing. Felony scratching. Originally published at libertyunderattack.com on June 30th, 2015, read to you by the author. Back in May, I was coerced by the threat of fine and/or incarceration to serve on a jury. It was certainly an interesting experience, but as I explained in the first felony scratching article, it was blatantly obvious that the punishment did not fit the crime, and regardless of her previous rap sheet, the injuries to the nurse were no more severe than a minor paper cut. As I explained in the first article, the possible charges were either a Class 3 felony, 2 to 5 years or 5 to 10 with aggravating factors, or a Class 1 felony, 4 to 15 years. Considering her aggravated battery charge involved a nurse working in her official capacity, the defendant was at a far higher risk for an increased sentence. As the picture clearly shows, in the original article, she only got 4 years, which is a major surprise to me. She didn't plea bargain out and took it all the way to a jury trial, so I figured they would throw the book at her and push for a maximum sentence. Nonetheless, 4 years in prison is a long time, and regardless of how good of a mother she was, constantly in and out of trouble with local police extortionists, her daughter will be without a mother for a long time. In addition to that, thanks to the felony and her past, we can be almost positive that things won't get better for this family, financially or stability-wise. From my Adventures in Illinois Law series, especially the jury summons, it only makes me despise the state's monopoly on arbitration and adjudication even more. When people serve time in prison, they don't come out the same. Usually, they come out as far worse criminals than they were before they went in. I certainly feel for the family and wish the common law principle of the punishment fitting the crime was a standard that we still lived by, although that is the only aspect of common law I am fond of now. I also do wish that proper restitution was a priority of these criminals in robes. Although, can we really expect any better moral behavior from this immoral injustice system? No, of course not. It's time to abandon the idea of authority and regain the basic values and principles that make us human beings. You just heard Sentencing, Felony Scratching, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on June 30th, 2015. Read to you by the author.
Behind Enemy Lines, The Dangers of the Libertarian Party. Originally published on July 10th, 2015 at libertyunderattack.com and read to you by the author. Consistent libertarians hold two philosophical axioms above all else. Those two are the non-aggression principle, which forbids all initiatory force, and the self-ownership axiom, which upholds private property rights and the ownership of one's body. If one is going to call themselves a libertarian, they must put those two philosophies first, or in all honesty, they aren't libertarians. My conscience has made me realize that being involved in the political process at all is a violation of both of the principles that consistent philosophical libertarians like myself deem extremely important. First off, the state is inherently anti-propertarian, because in order to allegedly protect our property rights, they must first violate our property rights. They express this in many ways, such as property taxes, their use of eminent domain and nuisance abatement, and the simple fact that they use force to deter us from putting substances into our own bodies. Next, voting in and of itself is a violation of the non-aggression principle. When you enter a voting booth and scratch shit on paper, or push a button, you are violently forcing your beliefs and preferences upon others. Even if you're voting for the most consistent liberty-minded candidate, you're still attempting to force freedom upon others. As Samuel Konkin mentioned in his 1980 New Libertarian Manifesto, quote, "It is part of the statist mystique to confuse the necessity of ends means consistency. It is thus the most crucial activity of the libertarian theorist to expose inconsistencies.
but we have attempted and most failed to describe the consistent means and ends combination of libertarianism, end quote. The Libertarian Party was founded in December of 1971, and since then they haven't accomplished anything. Their stated goal was to educate the people about true freedom, and winning elections was only a vehicle for spreading the message of liberty. Since their inception, we've only lost more freedoms, the government has only gotten bigger, and more Americans have become victims of democide and abuse. And their goal of education is almost a moot point, as they're teaching the gullible minarchists, that is, minimal statists, that the political process and restoring the republic are the only realistic ways to win back their freedoms. But most of all, the reason the LP is dangerous is because with its involvement in the political process, it is giving legitimacy to the most dangerous superstition, the belief in authority and government. I mention these details about the LP because I have been going on political field trips these past few months. My first one was at a McLean County board meeting. Another trip involved dealing with the employees in the McLean County Government Center in order to cancel my voter registration. Next, I was coerced to serve on a jury, and the final field trip was when I spectated a few criminal court proceedings. I figured that a good way to conclude my political field trips was to attend a reformist meeting and experience those naive folks who think they can infiltrate the KKK and turn it into the NAACP. So, on Tuesday, July 7th, I attended my first, and last, Libertarian Party meeting. The so-called business meeting was at Buffalo Wild Wings at 6 p.m. I trundled on in and found the local LP chapter members on the back patio. There were four others there when I arrived, including Chris Michael, who is an aspiring political ruler. I took a seat, introduced myself, and then we began engaging in small talk. I was asked a few personal questions, one of which included if I had voted in the special election that took place earlier that day. I had to bite my tongue because I could not state that I had already canceled my voter registration last April. If I would have told him that, then there would have been no reason for me to be there, and I did not want to invite suspicion as to why I had chosen to attend that evening. I instead replied with an answer along the lines of, nope, I wasn't fond of any of the choices. Thankfully, that too was the response of the gentleman that asked me. Let's call this person John for the sake of his privacy. John noticed my Liberty Under Attack voluntarist shirt and said, see that you're a voluntarist. It was just an observation, and from his reaction, I think he liked that fact. At that point, the LP members started discussing their political failures, and also those at the local GOP. As soon as I heard John's name, I immediately remembered seeing his signs around town from a year or two back when he was the aspiring political ruler. Nonetheless, I didn't expect to be back in my high school cafeteria, only this time with an adult beverage, hearing the local LP chapter membership gossip about the GOP. They were extremely into mainstream politics. They knew the imaginary titles of every successful and aspiring political ruler, and they even had titles themselves. John mentioned that his wife was the chairman of the Second Continental Army of the Pacific Fleet, as well as the fact that she used to be vice chairman of the Lollipop Guild. I don't remember their official titles, so these parodies will have to do. It's safe to say, then, that they are fond of the partyarchy, which is the anti-concept of pursuing libertarian ends through statist means that Konkin discussed back in the 80s. We'll return back to the titles momentarily. They were all genuinely nice people, and I did enjoy their company, even though I despised the fact that they were there to vet an aspiring political ruler to see if he was a potential candidate that the LP could endorse. After being there for about a half an hour, someone closer to my age entered and sat down. He was there to try to find other like-minded people, and he was very interested in joining the LP, which was evident since he drove 45 minutes to attend. At that point, the aspiring political ruler, Chris, stood up and gave his speech. He mentioned that he was a small business owner and enjoyed the freedom that it gave him, in comparison to being a corporate slave. He went on to do the thing all politicians do and emphatically stated, I want to be your candidate. All I could think looking at him was, sit the fuck down already. It wasn't simply the fact that he was standing up. It was because he wants my support to throw his weight around by way of government coercion. I did throw open my mouth a bit at that statement, but I maintained my composure and kept my ears open. At that point, three other members of this LP chapter showed up. There was an older, married couple and one committed, over-enthusiastic, reformist Uber employee. At that point, it was question time for Mr. Michael. John asked first, and of course, it was the cliche, why should I vote for you question. I don't remember the answer verbatim, but Michael responded with a cliche, vague answer, talking about how much he loves freedom and wants others to be free. John's wife then brought up the subject of social issues. I knew this was going to be interesting. The first one brought up was abortion. Brace yourselves. Michael took a page out of the pro-life Christian conservative handbook and proselytized about life beginning at conception. He believes abortion is murder and should be treated as such. I was taken aback, and I think a couple of the other LP chapter members were too. I think it's important here to point out an inconsistency in Michael's previous statement. If we look at the LP platform in section 1.5, we can see that he contradicted the party platform, which states, quote, "Recognizing that abortion is a sensitive issue and that people can hold good faith views on all sides, we believe that government should be kept out of the matter, leaving the question to each person for their conscientious consideration," end quote. Instead of it being a personal decision left outside the realm of government, Michael would be happy with government intervention against a medical procedure, at least in this regard. To make matters worse and more confusing in trying to get a handle on this guy, the next topic was homosexual marriage in regards to the recent Supreme Court ruling. Michael believes that the government should have nothing to do with marriage and people should be left alone to do as they wish in the privacy of their homes. Obviously, I agree, but if that personal decision should be left out of the realm of the state, then why not abortion too? Well, I think I have an answer. Michael isn't being consistent with the libertarian axiom of self-ownership or even with his supposed policies either. He isn't judging his beliefs based off of the twin axioms of libertarianism. Rather, he's being arbitrary and is basing it all off of how he feels, maybe even upon the political expediency of the moment. At that point, Michael continued on and stated that in the last election, he ran for Secretary of State for Illinois and lost miserably, as well as mentioning a slogan for his campaign. He calls it Five for Freedom, and what he was suggesting is that everyone give him $5 so that he can go off to D.C. and send libertarian shockwaves through the federal government. As if that has ever worked. Another question was asked, and it was, if there's one thing you could change if you were elected, what would it be? This may have been the only answer I genuinely liked from the man, although his inconsistencies and ambition to be my political ruler makes that almost a moot point. He said that it would be prison incarceration, as that would be a multifaceted victory. He mentioned the war on drugs and firearms regulations, as well as self-ownership for the second time that evening. At that point, the uber-ambitious gentleman stood up and started talking. As with most of the reformists, he loved making people aware of how important he was since he is the chairperson of the goat-herding division for McLean County. Titles of nobility much? After his stint of braggadocio, he started to talk about the successes of the LP since he took over his role. It was at this point that I knew for sure that these people weren't serious and that the LP was just a social club. The successes, described, consisted of walking in parades, designing floats, setting up booths at social events, and going to state fairs. So not only do they think they can infiltrate the state, but they also think they can win back our freedoms through social gatherings, somehow. The naivety was nothing less than astounding. I took a list of 7 questions with me, and prior to that point, the LP was digging themselves a deep hole without me even having to bring anything up. I decided I would ask one question. Mr. Michael, how do you feel about intellectual property and the copyright clause found in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8 of the Constitution? That was the only real question that was asked that evening, and the LP chapter members, including Michael, were taken aback by my question. Michael mentioned that the question was too direct and to explain further. I mentioned the DMCA claims on YouTube and how copyright is being used as censorship. I also explained that as a journalist, YouTuber, and radio show host, I have to be careful because even with the fair use doctrine, people have still been outright censored, such as Christy Aphrodite of Soul Journeys Radio. He admitted that he didn't know anything about what I was explaining and pulled a lame answer out of his ass.
Well, I think if you create something, you have the rights to it.
That was pretty much the extent of it. I wasn't surprised that he was completely unaware of one of the more important aspects of the Constitution that he wants to restore, being a libertarian senatorial candidate. Expecting consistency and competency is completely irrational when it comes to reformism. It doesn't matter which of the various flavors of reformism it is. This also brings up another worrisome point. Most political rulers that swear an oath to the Constitution don't even know what the document says. They don't know what the limits of their own powers are. That would be safe to say when it comes to Michael as well. It would be wise for Michael to know the document simply because it is the basis of the LP platform, but additionally, if Michael is running for the U.S. Senate, He needs to know the ins and outs of the federal constitution, something he surely does not. Overall, it's just an issue of competency, and Michael is incompetent. After I asked him that question, Michael and I began talking. He asked me what I did, and this is the point where I dropped some of my vagueness and told him. He was interested in checking out my work, so I gave him a business card. The other adult my age asked for a business card and joined in the conversation. I told him the type of things we discuss in LUA radio, minus the anarchic topics, of course. The adult my age started talking about radio hosts, authors, and philosophers that he enjoys. He mentioned Bob Murphy from the Mises Institute, Stefan Molyneux, and a couple of others, which surprised the hell out of me. He's certainly been looking around for a proper libertarian education, something he surely won't learn from the LP. Of course, Michael didn't know any of those folks, and I recommended Samuel Konkin to him, more specifically the 1985 debate between Konkin and Robert Poole, the founder of Reason magazine, titled, What is a Libertarian? Maybe then, he would learn that he isn't truly a libertarian. I stuck around for about a half an hour longer, and the meeting came to a close. John came up to me and invited me to their upcoming events and asked if I would be back to another meeting. Since they're all nice people, I was civil and just said, I think you will. Don't get me wrong, it was an outright lie, but I wasn't necessarily in the mood for a conflict or a debate. Larkin Rose wrote an article in September of 2010 titled, Libertarian Party Worthless. In this article, Rose states, quote, The Libertarian Party has ceased to be libertarian. They don't dare to bluntly describe what libertarianism entails, because that would scare too many potential voters who have been thoroughly indoctrinated into the cult of state worship. Instead of speaking about succinct, specific principles, libertarian candidates and spokesfolk muddle around in more publicly acceptable generalities. They want less of this and more of that. Less than what? More than what? What is the ultimate goal? What is the underlying principle? End quote. As I mentioned in the introduction, libertarianism is the synthesis of the non-aggression principle and the axiom of self-ownership. As I've also emphasized, consistency is everything. If one is going to call themselves a libertarian, then their actions must coincide with the overall philosophy of libertarianism. And if, then they are hypocrites and are more than likely members of the anti-libertarian Libertarian Party. In the 2 hours I met with the local LP chapter, I heard them mention self-ownership twice, but there wasn't a single mention of the non-aggression principle. Now, I'm sure some of you will think this is rather harsh criticism, and you might even want to accuse me of hurting the movement, as some have been accused of in the past. But I am compelled by my conscience to call out inconsistencies, hypocrisies, and everyone must recognize the LP for what it is, dangerous. The only way the state can exist is through hallucinatory tendencies, such as being involved in the political process, or by the belief in the myth of authority at all. The LP is only furthering the hallucination by giving it legitimacy, in addition to all of their massive failures since its inception. There's also an opportunity cost issue here. If they would reallocate all of the time and resources they dedicate in the political process into other things that actually work, or at least have a much higher possibility of working, then maybe we could regain our freedoms in a more timely manner, such as through the economic means. From my experiences with LP members in the past, and from this political field trip experience, it is safe to say that the Libertarian Party is libertarian-leaning, and even then, only on a good day. I'll leave you with this quote by St. Bernard of Clairvaux, which succinctly sums up their actions. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. You've just heard Behind Enemy Lines, The Dangers of the Libertarian Party, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on July 10th, 2015, and read to you by the author. For an in-depth follow-up discussion, make sure to tune into the July 12th broadcast of LUA Radio at fprnradio.com/libertyunderattack.
Adventures in Illinois Law, An Encounter with a Blue Coat. Originally published at libertyunderattack.com on July 16th, 2015, and read to you by the author. Many Americans are beginning to recognize the devolving political climate that we are living in. The list of grievances is constantly growing, and the abuse by the state onto its citizenry certainly provides a grim outlook for the future. The abuses don't stop at violence, democide, or even imprisonment. A great deal of the abuse comes in the form of user fees and fines. In Roger Roots' academic white paper titled Are Cops Constitutional, he makes the voracious statement that, quote, in effect, road travel itself is subject to a near-total level of police control, end quote. The state is surely milking the cash cow of its monopoly on roads, and since everyone has to travel at some point, no one can avoid the physical and financial abuse that takes place on government roads. The majority of police extortionist encounters take place in the form of normal traffic stops. The reasons can range from speeding expired registration, running traffic signals, all the way to giving a cop the well-deserved finger while driving. In addition to that, when you are detained in a traffic stop, the police extortionist is conducting an investigation to see if there's anything else they can potentially pin on you. First thing, other than running your plates and turning on the magic lights, the first thing the officer does is take a look in your car to see if there's any contraband or anything suspicious, utilizing the plain view doctrine. Next, they will attempt to get a confession from the operator, and most of the time they are successful. Progressing through the encounter, the police extortionist will continue the attempt in getting the operator to talk to see if there is any way to escalate the traffic stop, potentially in the form of a search of the vehicle. If at any point the operator shows the police extortionist disrespect, that will automatically escalate the situation, and they will more than likely be asked to get out of the car. If at any time the operator resists this use of force, the police extortionist will only escalate the violence to the point of severe injury or even death. Additionally, potential charges of resisting arrest or disobeying a lawful order. Many basic traffic stops have turned deadly, and the price for any of the minor infractions listed above could lead to an early death. On July 15th, I had my own experience in dealing with one of these police extortionists. Thankfully, I'm still alive to write this article. This is a Facebook status I posted a couple hours after the encounter. Today, an armed thug with a hallucinatory sense of authority in a blue costume stopped me at the side of the road and held me hostage until I promised him that I would pay his extortion fee. I didn't hurt anyone, and the only reason for this violent, dangerous interaction was because I was a couple months behind on paying the yearly extortion tax. Fuck you, police extortionists. Continuing on with the article. I've had a few run-ins with police extortionists in the past, so this wasn't the first time, the last one being 2 to 3 years ago. Albeit, it was the first encounter I've had after I started role-playing police interrogations. Time was early morning. I had just gotten breakfast and was heading to work. About halfway through my daily commute, a police extortionist pulled up behind me. I wasn't concerned as I wasn't speeding or violating any of the other arbitrary traffic infractions. The police extortionist followed me for a couple of miles, and when I turned left, he followed. At that point, I still thought I was okay, and as soon as that crossed my mind, the magic lights came on. For the first time in my history of police extortionist run-ins, I wasn't panicking. It was more so just, what in the fuck is he pulling me over for? I decided that I wasn't going to audio or video record the encounter for whatever reason. After a brief moment, Officer Friendly walked up and asked me how I was doing. I dodged that question and immediately responded with, "Sir, can I ask why you pulled me over?" He promptly responded with, "Your registration expired in March. It is July." From my training in police interrogations, instead of mouthing off by saying, "Well, no shit, Sherlock, did they teach you your months at the police academy?" I responded with, "Oh, it is? Forgot all about that." The next demand was that I show my papers. I handed the police extortionist my ID, but I could not find my proof of insurance, reason being I was a dumbass and hadn't put an updated one in there for nearly a year. He then asked if all of the information on the ID was correct, and this may have been my only mistake, albeit a minor one. I told him that the address on the ID is wrong, but it's updated in the system. He mentioned my street address, and I confirmed that it was correct. He instructed me to continue looking, and if I find it, just to wave my arm out the window. He then advised, "If you can't find proof of insurance, I have to assume you are driving in an uninsured vehicle, and will issue a citation for that as well." He then went back to his cruiser and wrote me my citations. After about 5 minutes of waiting, hoping that this wouldn't make me late for work, a second police extortionist pulled up. They greeted each other, and the second police extortionist stood on the sidewalk with his arms crossed in an authoritative manner. I didn't have any interaction with the second one. About 5 more minutes passed, and the officer came back to speak with me. He stated that, "I wrote you 2 citations. The first one is for the expired registration, which requires no court appearance. The second one is for driving an uninsured motor vehicle. That is a Class A misdemeanor and does require a court appearance. If you go to court and prove that you are insured, this misdemeanor will be dropped, but it is up to the state's attorney if you are required to pay the fine. All I need you to do now is sign the ticket." End quote. I asked him, "Well, what are the ramifications if I don't sign the ticket?" He responded with, "Then I have to take your license as bond. When you sign the ticket, you are not admitting guilt. It's just a guarantee that you will attend your court hearing." Satisfied as much as I could be by the response, I signed the ticket. He then asked, "Have you had any bad interactions with police officers in the past? You seem nervous and fidgety, and you asked about signing the ticket." I responded with, "Sirs, is that relevant?" He shot back, "No, but as a police officer, it is my job to look out for those signs. Are you feeling okay?" I wasn't going to deal with this line of interrogation for any longer, so I asked, "Am I free to go?" He responded with, "Yes, the traffic stop is over." I told him that I was going to leave and to have a good day. As I drove away, I looked in the rearview mirror and saw the two police extortionists chit-chatting in the street. I would be interested in hearing how that conversation went. On the way to work, I examined the tickets for any errors, which would invalidate them. Unfortunately, I did not find any. When I got home from work that evening, I looked up the charges in the Illinois compiled statutes. For driving an uninsured motor vehicle that is found in 625 ILCS, Chapter 5, Section 3-707. Quote, "However, no person charged with violating the section shall be convicted if such person produces in court satisfactory evidence that at the time of the arrest the motor vehicle was covered by a liability insurance policy in accordance with Section 7-601 of this code," end quote. I do have car insurance, so this one is a non-issue, just a major inconvenience. For the expired registration, the ILCS is vague on the fines and punishments. Vague, meaning that they provide nothing to the effect at all. The charge for this one is found in 625 ILCS, Chapter 5, Section 3-413, Subsection F. Quote, "No person shall operate a vehicle nor permit the operation of a vehicle upon which is displayed an Illinois registration plate, or registration stickers after the termination of the registration period for which issued or after the expiration date set pursuant to Sections 3-414 and 3-414.1 of this code," end quote. I did some further research on this charge, and if I show initiative and pay the extortion tax for the renewal, then there is a chance that this might be dropped altogether. I was unable to find the fine for 2015, but in 2009, the fine was $90. Since then, the fines have all gone up, so I can expect to pay a bit more if the charge isn't dropped. I did my due diligence and went and got my registration renewed the day after I received the citation, so hopefully I can get that one dropped as well. Conclusion. I thought I was finished with the Adventures in Illinois Law series after my trip to a local Libertarian Party chapter meeting. I certainly didn't envision a violently coercive encounter with the local police extortionists. To put it frankly, I'm not even so much angered because of the potential fines and guaranteed user fees. Obviously, there are some issues with that when it comes to the right to travel, but that is a topic that will be saved for another time. What angered me the most from this encounter is that I was put into a dangerous, violently coercive situation, all because the ink on my registration sticker wasn't positioned correctly or in the right shape. That is the simplest way to put it. Many other police extortionist encounters have been for things even more minor than that, and the drivers sometimes didn't make it out alive. Finally, the state is imposing an opportunity cost upon me. Instead of spending that time on other, certainly more important things, I am being coerced into attending yet another court proceeding, only in this case it will be my own. It's time to acknowledge that we live in the United Police States of America. We must also recognize that all police extortionists are our enemies. Their jobs are immoral. They swear an oath to the Constitution, but their job is unconstitutional on its face, making the Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers, CSPOA, and the Oath Keepers look rather hypocritical. Additionally, being a police extortionist is not a dangerous job. According to their own statistics, it doesn't even make the top 10. To conclude, the police state we live in is not making America safer, on the contrary, rather. Government policing is dangerous and a detriment to our lives, liberty, and property. It would behoove us to consider also that police extortionists carry out the orders and do the bidding for the most dangerous superstition. "I'm just doing my job," or "I'm just enforcing the law," are no excuses and are the same ridiculous phrases that the Nazi officers in World War II said when they were sending millions of Jews into gas chambers to become victims of democide. There are much better alternatives, the most plausible one being the privatization of security, where the consumers decide which businesses are actually protecting their life, liberty, and property, rather than having to rely on an unaccountable, run-amok government monopoly. It is also the utilization of the economic means rather than the political ones, which has a much higher chance of success in regaining our liberty. You've just heard Adventures in Illinois Law, An Encounter with a Bluecoat, originally published at libertyunderattack.com. Adventures in Illinois Law, A Meeting with the State's Attorney. Originally published at libertyunderattack.com on August 18th, 2015, and read to you by the author. Anytime someone drives on the government-monopolized roads, they risk arbitrary, coercive traffic stops by the road pirate police extortionists. Most traffic stops are for victimless crimes, and oftentimes they outright abuse the precautionary principle. These potentially violent encounters are deceptively labeled under the guise of public safety or the common good, but the real reason is extortion. Last month, I was pulled over on the way to work for expired registration and was slammed with another citation for driving without insurance since I didn't provide sufficient proof. Since the latter citation was a misdemeanor, I was ordered to appear in court today. Prior to the court date, I had looked through the Illinois compiled statutes and discovered that the driving without insurance charge would be dropped as soon as I provided proof that I was insured at the time. For the expired registration citation, the ILCS is pretty vague and listed no fine associated with it. I sincerely hope that I would not have to pay another fine in addition to the late registration fee. It was time to enter the belly of the beast known as the McLean County Law and Injustice Center and see what those who imagine themselves to be my rulers will extort from me this time. Inside the belly of the beast. I'd like to mention in passing that this will be my third time in McLean County Law and Injustice Center in just 3 months, so you can only imagine how familiar I am with this building. I woke up today quite pissed off and began my journey to downtown Bloomington. I arrived an hour early and waited in the parking garage until 8:30 a.m. when I had to call the Van Buren County Government in Michigan to pay for the other ticket that I received on my way to the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest 3. If you experienced what I did today, you would hate to stay with the same vehement passion that I do. Granted, it was for minor infractions, but it was pure extortion nonetheless, and I was forced to miss my very first higher-level indoctrination class of this semester. Coincidentally enough, I missed American government and politics. I walked into the building at 8:45 a.m., went through the metal detectors, and headed up to courtroom 3B. I checked in with the state's employee, and he instructed me to head into the courtroom. The state's attorney entered at the same time as me, and the running of citizens through the gauntlet of statism ensued. I witnessed a few speeding tickets for drivers under the age of 18, arbitrary paperwork violations, and a couple of people only coming to prove that they were insured at the time of the extortionist encounter. It was extremely dull, as this was just basic traffic court. Surprisingly, the government was on time for the first time in the history of humanity, and I was called up to speak with the state's attorney at 9 a.m. She looked over the tickets, and I showed her proof that I was insured at the time of the encounter, and they dismissed that ticket. I also provided her the proof that the day after I was pulled over, I went and got my registration renewed. I kissed ass and told her that I work full-time and go to school and that I had just simply forgotten about it, and apologized sincerely. Luckily, she dismissed that one too, thanked me for coming in as if I had a choice, and told me I was good to go. No additional fines, no court fees, and both citations off of my record. I won this battle with the state, but it was certainly a nuisance. Additionally, I didn't enjoy being there for a case that involved me. In my previous trips, I was either serving on a jury or just voluntarily spectating, and that was a completely different experience. Hopefully, I never have to enter a government building again, but I know that's a naive thought. After I completed my political field trips, or at least I thought I did, I was so done with every facet of government, and I was overjoyed to have had those completed and the articles up on my experiences. Barring any unfortunate circumstances in the future, I can now say that the Adventures in Illinois Law series is completed, and now I can focus on collaborating with other voluntarists, anarchists, and libertarians, and start finding solutions using the economic means. You've just heard Adventures in Illinois Law, A Meeting with the State's Attorney, originally published at libertyunderattack.com on August 18th, 2015, and read to you by the author. Afterward. In March of this year, Kyle Reardon from the Last Bastille blog was pointed in the direction of Matt and I by Ryan, the founder and producer of the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. Kyle tossed us an idea for a broadcast regarding Dragnet wiretapping, and we graciously accepted. Since that time, we've had quite a few conversations on endless amounts of topics. In April, just a short month after our first interview with him, Kyle introduced me to the concept of canceling my voter registration. I made a few trips down to the McLean County Government Center and was successful in my mission. The next idea he proposed was one that I've taken to the fullest extent possible, going on political field trips to witness tyranny firsthand. It's often said that my generation isn't involved enough in politics, and that it is worrisome to many older folks. We don't participate, we don't attend county board meetings, and we don't vote, to name a few examples. I would go as far as to say that most of those folks that are recommending the younger generations to do those things haven't actually witnessed the state themselves in its own natural habitat, its daily operating procedure per se. That is exactly what I did, and contrary to what many of my generation have been told, it accelerated my evacuation off of the Minarchist ship rather than make me want to become more involved in politics. Witnessing the inherent coercion and violence of the state firsthand through these political field trips could be a major tool in assisting others to make the jump to true freedom, anarchy. That is my major inspiration for this anthology, to document my experiences and to show them to others in the most direct, personal way possible. Lastly, I hope others will emulate my example and do these in the tax farms where they live, whether anarchist, minarchist, or statist. There is only one way to freedom, and that is through anarchy. You can't be free with political rulers. Shane Radliff, Bloomington, Illinois, August 2015.
A note from Matt K. Shane's Adventures in Illinois Law series is an educational, experience-driven walkthrough on the failures of statist adherents, with a first-hand look and feel of just what happens within the realm of local government. Consistent with the drive to achieve a lifestyle focused around direct action instead of reformism, Shane rightfully criticizes the authoritarian doctrines and course of nature of the courtroom and police encounters. A recommended read for students seeking material outside the realm of public state-based education or obedience training. Shane provides necessary perspectives from being a defendant and a juror in the McLean County injustice system. He shows the positive results in keeping your life and your skin in the face of extortionist tax enforcers by the experience of role-playing police interrogations. By canceling his voter registration, Shane has proven the effective nature of legally opting out of the electoral nightmare of party politics and the contest of wannabe rulers attempting to run for different offices across the country. This is a step that you can make yourselves by visiting our Cancel Your Voter Registration page on the Liberty Under Attack website. While I don't share Shane's experiences and dealing with government and its many dangerous facets and adherence, honestly, well, two people always share the exact same experience all the time. We do have a mutual understanding of desiring to live in a country and world based on direct action instead of reformist means. This has consistently kept the LUA-ETTW partnership strong, despite my somewhat outsider views as Shane roughed through the absurdity of the LP's partyarchy. This enlightening adventure through communist state law should provide a well-reasoned prerogative to encourage a different means of resolving issues Illinoisans and Americans overall are faced with on an annual basis of living in the land of the enslaved. Yours in Anarchy, Matt K., August 2015.